Hi, dear friends. Today I'll be sharing a few practical tips on managing a case with posterior capsule rent during phacoemulsification and how to prevent a nucleus drop. This looks to be a routine case. This is a 65-year-old patient with a nuclear cataract. My axis turns out to be a little bit on the bigger side than what actually I would have liked. In these denser nucleus, my preferred technique is stop and chop. Whenever a PC tear happens, it's quite challenging for us to find out exactly at what step did the PC tear happen. And it took me multiple reviews to come to this conclusion. So I'm laterally separating the two heminuclei and proceed to perform my first chop. And this is a step where I believe that the PC tear actually happened. The phaco tip is far too peripheral for my liking, and this is when probably it would have happened. And we can notice that the fragment is lying horizontal at this stage, which is very unusual in this situation. So I continue with my chopping of the next fragment. I'm trying to laterally separate this, and I'm feeling something unusual about this now. So I pull the nuclear fragment much more anteriorly and then try to emulsify it. Momentarily it looks all right. I'm able to emulsify 1/3 of the nuclear fragment. And at this point, I notice that something has happened. The replay shows small epinucleus descending down. A slight increase in the red glow and a mild deepening in the anterior chamber. I am staring at a large PC tear. So my first reaction is to ensure that the chamber does not shallow. I push in dispersive OVD from the side port before pulling out the phaco probe. The OVD plugs the posterior capsular tear and provides tamponade and ensures that the nuclear fragments don't descend posteriorly. At this point, I need to strategize my next move. After a momentary pause, I decide to convert to SICS by creating a superior sclerocorneal tunnel. I shift my position superiorly, and since this case was being done in a topical anesthesia, I am supplementing it with a posterior subcutaneous block using a blunt cannula. I usually avoid cautery. My assistant is constantly irrigating to help me see better. I'm creating a tunnel, the plane of which is below the plane of the original side port incision. So once the sclerocorneal tunnel of about 6 to 6.5 mm is created, I use a 2.8 mm keratome to enter the eye and then extend on either side with the inner lip of the tunnel being parallel to the limbus. Under the cover of the viscoelastic, the two smaller nuclear fragments are expressed out. Then the large heminucleus is gently maneuvered out of the bag using two Sinsky hooks. Adequate amount of OVD is constantly being used to protect the corneal endothelium. It is then extracted out using a vectus and a dialer. Again, I shift my position to the temporal side and proceed with antivitrectomy. I first stain with diluted triamcinolone acetate. At this point, I don't see any prolapsed vitreous. However, we can see some lens matter in the anterior vitreous. as I continue, I'm able to maneuver around the lens matter and consume it with my cutter. Once the soft epinuclear matter is eaten away by the cutter, at this point, I'm able to really assess the size and extent of the PC tear, and it's a quite a large one. After performing adequate anterior vitrectomy, I am removing the cortex using the cutter in the IA mode itself. It can be done, and later on switching to the bimanual cannula to remove the cortex. An important point to note here is that the cortex aspiration has to be done only after doing adequate vitrectomy and the vitreous is totally clear from the anterior chamber. At this point, I realize that the pupil has come down in size. I'm using BSS with adrenaline, which would help me to dilate the pupil a little bit. Again, I shift superiorly, and the plan is to implant a multi-piece acrylic lens in the sulcus. After placing the haptic over the anterior capsule, I am dialing the other haptic into the sulcus over the anterior capsule. To counter the pre-existing against-the-wall astigmatism, I have used a single radial suture. After removing the OVD, I am trying to have an optic capture, which is quite difficult because of the large rexus in this case. Anyway, the lens was well centered. And one last time, I'm checking for the presence of any vitreous by using triamcinolone acetate. On the conjunctiva was closed using 80 vicryl, and this is how the case looked at the end of the surgery. And third postoperative day, the case looks fine and almost indistinguishable from a routine one. Well, unexpected complications do occur. In this stressful situation, our ability to think is compromised. There's a lack of clarity in our thoughts. Invariably, this results in poor decision making, which aggravates the mess which we are already in. In this particular case, we could have had a nucleus drop. Hence, in such situations, we must always have a game plan ready with standardized protocols to face these unexpected challenges. Being prepared with a game plan makes us more confident, and we're not relying purely on our instincts. This ensures appropriate decision making, which in turn helps in achieving excellent outcomes. In this case, we have a large central PC tear with an overlying nucleus. In such a scenario, we have got three goals to achieve: prevent the nucleus drop, protect the rexus so that we have support to place the lens, and prevent corneal endothelial damage. To address these three goals, I prefer to stick to these five rules in the event of a PC tear with nucleus in situ. And the first rule, the early diagnosis. This is probably the most important and also the most difficult one to make, because the PC tear is difficult to appreciate due to the overlying nucleus, which obstructs the view. The subtle change in the anterior chamber dynamics should warrant us, when in doubt, always err towards the diagnosis of PC tear. Denial is the commonest mistake, which invariably proves expensive. Once the diagnosis of the PC tear is made, the second rule is to inject dispersive OVD under the nuclear fragments. This will provide tamponade and prevent the nuclear fragments from dropping down into the vitreous. In the presence of significant amount of nucleus in an eye with a large central PC tear, it's always wise to convert to SICS and extract the remaining fragments manually. This single step prevents, most often than not, the nucleus drops from happening, and also helps in protecting the rexus and also minimizing damage to the corneal endothelium. Triamcinolone-assisted anterior vitrectomy is the next important step. We prefer to use diluted triamcinolone acetate, and only after adequate anterior vitrectomy is performed, the cortex has to be aspirated. And finally, the IL implantation has to be done, either in the sulcus or in the bag, depending on the extent of the PC tear. By sticking to these five basic rules, we can have excellent outcomes which are indistinguishable from our routine cases. A commonly debated question, should we continue phacoing in the presence of a PC tear? Well, it depends on two important factors. The skill level and the experience of the surgeon, and the presence of an in-house backup team to manage the nucleus drop. I prefer to use the IOL scaffold technique if the following three distinct criteria are fulfilled. Visibility is good and PC tear is small, less than 20% nucleus is remaining, and the nucleus is very soft. In this technique, there is a constant for space. We end up doing phaco more anteriorly, putting the corneal endothelium at risk. The bottom line is, when in doubt, it's always better to keep it simple. Convert. There's absolutely no shame in doing so. The best interest of a patient is your only interest. Thank you. Hope this helps.